My name is Srikant, and I work with an MNC as a Google Cloud architect. I have like 15 years experience in industry, and I've been working in Google Cloud and Azure for the last 5 years or so. I mainly focus about data side of technologies. I mean, like I work on on-premise and on-cloud data platforms. That's me. For Container Engine and Kubernetes, we do have a complete section dedicated, that is module 5. Before any questions, let me give you how this entire learning is divided. So we have 7 modules. These are basic modules, module 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which are visible on your screen. If you don't have this open, you can look at here. So first section of module is the basics of what is Google Cloud Platform and how it is divided into different components and everything. And just so that you get into a cloud idea, we'll be going ahead with how cloud components are divided into 3 types of components, which are infrastructure as a service and platform as a service, and there is one more component which is called software as a service, that is not mentioned here because we can go ahead and do it in our ways. Second module is about a more deeper dive of what exactly is Google Cloud Platform and use cases, how exactly we are going to use Google Cloud Platform. Third is about App Engine and Cloud Data Store. App Engine is how you deploy your apps into Google Cloud. We'll try and use how exactly we can deploy our apps there. And then the fourth module will be storage options, which are like different storage options for different users. Cloud storage is your file storage, and Cloud SQL for your SQL needs, and Bigtable is your NoSQL needs. Those kind of topics will be covered there. Module 5 is more of like containers, Kubernetes, and how a containerized applications will be deployed into cloud. We'll have a look at how exactly this can be done, and how we'll see how we can do this. Number 6 is Compute Engine. When you talk about Compute Engine, as I mentioned earlier, like we'll go ahead how exactly a Compute Engine can be deployed into cloud, and we see what kind of Compute Engines, I mean like what kind of configurations available for Compute Engine. And 7 is about Big Data, all about Big Data platforms, Dataproc, and how exactly you can you build your pipelines and how exactly you can spin up your big data instances. You'll see that there. And once we have covered with all these 7 modules, we'll go into a bit more advanced topics, which are these. We are looking at my screen currently. So before going to that, any questions on these topics?
Not mentioned cloud build in this syllabus, right?
Syllabus, we don't have anything specially as cloud build, but cloud build comes into picture when we discuss about these container engine and everything. So cloud build and cloud run are something like how we can deploy the applications into Google Cloud.
I know that is CI/CD tools, deploying tools, but we don't have in syllabus, right?
We don't have in syllabus. I mean, like in this sheet, we haven't mentioned it, but we will cover that topic.
Okay, and we will work with GitHub and Cloud Build also, right?
GitHub, we'll see if we can have a GitHub session with Google Cloud or not. But mostly, I could promise you that before going to any further confusions, this will be going to be a show and tell session. I'll log into my personal Google Cloud account, and I'll show you what components we have and how exactly this is going to work. And moreover, after that, when we have some time, after the session is completed, we'll be able to go through the lab kind of thing. I mean, I'll show you how exactly a particular thing can be done, and then you can go ahead and do it at your own thing.
Yeah, okay, thank you, sir. I will discuss later. Thank you.
Yeah. The extra topics are advanced topics, which I mentioned here, are like more of like data oriented. First one is about big data, and the second one is about how data processing architecture should be, and what kind of storage will be required for these things. Again, data prop comes into picture when you talk about your big data on cloud. PubSub is your streaming data pipelines. And then, the last one will be your favorite thing about chatbots. This will be a detailed thing, and we'll try to do a bit more deeper dive for this thing. That's why this is a detailed chapter for chatbot. Okay.
Srikanth, I have a couple of questions. So before getting started, like why we should prefer Google Cloud apart from the when you compare to Azure and AWS,
that's our module one. Let's go ahead with that. Okay.
Sure.
Google Cloud Platform advantages. When you really look about cloud, there are three or four major competitors in the field, and all of us know about that, I think. Let's go ahead with them. One is Azure, and the other one is AWS, and third one is Google Cloud Cloud, as I say. But there are still others as well, Alibaba Cloud, Oracle Cloud, and nowadays everyone is coming up with their own cloud instances. So when you say advantages of Google Cloud Platform, you know how big is Google, right? Google has at least 40% of internet storage, internet traffic goes to Google.
Srikanth, your voice is breaking too much.
Yeah, can you hear me loud and clear now?
Yeah, it's better.
I was saying we have I don't have a separate slide for this module one to cover. It will be more of you can Google and get to know kind of thing, but still I'll be able to guide you through why exactly Google Cloud have most of the advantages when using with comparative to other cloud platforms. So AWS and Azure are industry leaders, I would say, in different sectors, I would say. And Google is competing with both of these across the platforms. AWS is more known for their web hosting and other areas, and Azure is more of data side of it. But Google Cloud Platform is competing with these two in those two sectors as well, because Google is really trying to push into have multiple data centers across the globe. As of now, they have something around 53 or so data centers. Let me show you that map. Yeah, these are the regions and zones in which 76 zones, sorry, I had my numbers wrong. These are 25 regions across the globe and 76 zones. So network edge locations are locations where from which all these Google Cloud components can start working. So this is the bigger view of how exactly this is working on. So recently they have launched one more region here. I'm not sure if they have mentioned it here. Let me go. So the first advantage is Google Cloud has a bigger network of covering all over the globe. Okay, they removed it. Seems like, what I meant is they had a note here last week or so mentioning the recently deployed new network, which is in Poland, I believe, Poland Warsaw. Yeah, here, this one is the latest one. So this is the network coverage for Google. Just a minute, what is this? Yeah, this is the network coverage. Other platforms do have a wider network coverage like this, but not compared to this, because Google has all this coverage because Google has been the search provider for the last 20 years or so, right? So that's where Google has this kind of capability of having it multi-regions and multiple zones within the region. if you see browse through here in this page, you will see for Asia Pacific, within Asia we have like multiple regions, which are like in India we have Mumbai, and in in Singapore and like other locations within the Asia region. So these are the Asia regions which within we have. Within US also we have multiple regions. Within Europe also we have multiple regions. So with this kind of network, what happens is it will be really beneficial if you are trying to have a multiple places hosted a website or something which is running, and you can divert your traffic to multiple places in case if a failure happens at any of the locations. So that's the first advantage, I would say. Because of the huge coverage of Google, everyone would love to prefer Google. The second advantage I would like to say is the pricing. How Google prices these components is really interesting, because we have something called as Google pricing calculator. Just a minute, let me show you that as well. I think I had it at the bottom. Let's go to the pricing calculator directly. So initially, I'd like to mention a good point here. Yeah, this is a good way of doing it, I think, because it just triggered me a new point. Initially, when the cloud platforms launched, they never had this per second billing, and Google started this per second billing as far as I know. So per second billing lets you use your money as precisely or as effectively as you can have. So that's the best advantage of using Google. And Google gives you discounts as well in this pricing calculator. So you will have all the components here, whatever the components you want to take from Google and use it before you actually use it, and mention to get an idea of it. This is just to estimate how much your compute engine or app engine going to cost you. So cloud, anyone have any idea? Anyone wants to go ahead with any component they want to choose? We have all the components here. Anybody?
Yeah, compute engine is fine.
Cloud storage. Yeah, let's go. Compute engine, you said, but let me go with cloud storage because it's easier to understand cloud storage. So cloud storage is having multiple storage options, but in this calculator, you can see it's going to pop you for the standard storage first, and then it will go and ask you about the archival storage, nearline storage, and like these are the multiple types of storage. I'm gonna cover the next part of this as well, but it seems, let's go ahead. So standard storage is Google Cloud Storage. When you want to store your data, which should be available for you like 99.99% with more availability, and there won't be any drop on the network side of it. So you can choose your location. Let's go ahead with anything within India or within, let's put it like as default. And storage options, you can normally this storage options would have all the kind of parameters here, whether you want to have it go have to go for petabytes or terabytes. Let's take some 200 TB or something like that. You won't be costing that much for anything. Yeah, class A operations per month and class B operations are the operations, like how many times you are going to access this storage and save some data or retrieve some data. Those are called as class A operations and class B operations. Let's take 2 million per month or like 2 million per class B as well. Free storage estimate, you can include it here, and you can add this to estimate. So this will give you what kind of cost it can incur. I gave like too much of heavy estimate here. That's why you see a lot of cost here. Again, when you go into further into the pricing calculator, you can see nearline storage. Nearline storage is nothing but you can have your data as close as you want within that location or within that zone where you have your platform project created. So that is called nearline storage, and nearline storage will let you access your data with a lot of precision and accuracy, and it won't have any downtime virtually. So you can add your nearline storage, let's say something like some 2 TB or something. So this is an advantage. I mean, like, just to reiterate where we are, why we are looking at this is because Google Cloud gives you this pricing calculator, which will let you estimate what kind of amount you need to spend before you spend that amount, and what are the locations, and like, what are the why, where exactly your amount is going in. So that's where I'm trying to show you. Sorry, sometimes I tend to go deeper and forget about where exactly we started. So nearline we have added here, and we have added standard nearline, and there will be two more options, as cold line and archive. Cold line is where you don't have much of use. I mean, when you don't have too many class A or class B operations. I mean, you will not be writing into much of cold line, and you will not be retrieving more of data from cold line. Then you put that data into cold line storage. And then the last one is archive storage. Archive is nothing but you want to use it as a silo. When I meant silo, you'll store that data in there, and you'll have it for a reference, maybe in yearly wise or like half yearly wise kind of thing. We'll just go into archive storage when and if only the need arises. But you're not going to have that archive storage as your main storage, and then you want to retrieve data or store data frequently. Okay. So this is how the pricing looks. The pricing, the numbers are big here, but this numbers, if you forget this, for a 2 TB storage, you're just spending $20 per month. And if you want to increase your cloud storage, you don't really need to do anything. As in, when you go on increasing your cloud storage, it will add some amount of billing to your billing here. But it won't stop after 2000 GB here, as mentioned. Okay, 2 TB mentioned. Yeah, and let's go back to the section where we have this. Okay, I asked past, we haven't covered this, right? Like, we're still talking about advantages and components only. Okay, yep. So this is the advantage of using Google Cloud Platform. One, the bigger network, the wider network you can possibly have on the earth, and they will have their own network lines. It's not like they are gonna use some other vendor's internet connections or something like that. They have their own network through which their data flows, and that's why these networks are so faster. They virtually don't have any downtime. Second thing is Google Cloud will give you a per second billing, and it will give you a cloud calculator. These kind of calculators are available in AWS as well, and they do have a better way of calculating it as well. But this will give you a holistic understanding of how exactly you're going to spend your money on different options at a single note. You can add one more component here. Let's say compute engine you want to add. You can choose a compute engine, and it will give you number of instances. I mean, like, you can go ahead and add this compute instance to your estimate of storage as well. So at the end of the day, you can see all of your components combinedly estimated together. That's how it is going to show you. Hope this clarifies what are the advantages I'm looking at for when we use Google Cloud Platform. Any questions, guys?
Yeah, Shrikant. if you do this course, what can we target? Like, is it for the developer's perspective or like system admin perspective? Like, who can do this? Who can have this course?
The 50% of this course is completely basics of how exactly Google Cloud Platform is going to work across all the components, mostly which are mentioned in here. So there is some components which are not mentioned. I'll be able to browse those components for understanding purpose. And then the main purpose will be advanced topics which we have here. Either data side as a developer or an architect, or like who just want to understand data platform side of it, for them this advanced topic would do much good. And last one is about chatbot, so we'll try to build a chatbot and see how exactly that's going to work as well. So as per the syllabus, we have half of the course is completely basics about Google Cloud Platform, and the next half would be more detailed look into the data platforms of Hadoop and big data topics, and then data proc, pub/sub, all these come into data platforms only. They'll be bit more detailed on like how exactly you can ingest data and how exactly you should construct your pipelines, kind of thing. Streaming and batch pipelines. The last item, chatbot, will be chatbot will be more focused about like how exactly we can configure a chatbot and what are the components will be needed. That's the deeper dive we have there. Just a minute.
Any shell programming is required here?
Programming, understand programming, that is handy for you. But as I said, like the basics, to understand basic, you don't need any programming, because I'll be able to show and tell kind of session. This is right. I said already, right? So I'll show you what it is, and I'll show you how it can be done without programming and with programming as well. So it will be handy if you know programming, but programming is not a mandatory to understand any of these. So this course will give you a basic understanding of Google Cloud Platform. And if you want to do deeper dive into any of the components, if you have that component within these advanced topics, it will do more good. If it is not there, I can give you a basic idea of how that component is going to work, and I can drive you through that component. Maybe you want to do your hands dirty and get some coding experience within that component. That's also I can kind of support thing. But if it is within this, it is well and good. If it is not within this, I'll be able to guide you through it, but you will have to do it a bit more than completely show and tell, and then I'll show you that. Yeah, coming back to how our session is going to be, what I'm going to do is I'll have my personal account on Google Cloud. Just a minute, console.dot. Yeah.
Can we have free tier account for Google Cloud?
Yeah, that's where I'm going. This is my free tier account. So I haven't set up my $300 thing with this account yet. So I'm going to do that, and we are going to do it hand in hand. Like I can set my account and you can set your account within that 10 minute span, and then we can go ahead and browse through the components and we'll start doing that. I had like multiple other free projects created, but none of them are using any of my $300 yet. So I'll have to set it up and then I'll do that. So for anyone who don't know what this $300 I'm talking about, it's not the money you want to pay or you need to pay. $300 credit Google Cloud is going to give you free to spend within this console. This is the Google Cloud Platform console. When you log in, when you sign up and log into your account, this is my account. This console will let you access any of the Google Cloud Platform components within this. So I'll give you a deeper dive of how this works later on. Okay. Any questions? If no questions, let us go back to our regular agenda. Yeah, so we'll go through this networks and infrastructure, but let me guide you through this this topic first, understanding the differences between IaaS and PaaS. So whenever you are looking at any Google Cloud or any other cloud component, the component are like anything you want to work with within that component is mostly, I mean, like to understand as a basic need, what is cloud? Cloud lets you do what? Cloud components lets you do without having any infrastructure in your home or at your office. They will let you do the regular computing or any kind of hosting or any kind of networking they will enable. So to do this, what they do is, they will have different components which can cater to all these needs. When we say infrastructure as code, infrastructure as a service, not as code. When you say infrastructure as service, what they do is they will give you a service which you can use as an infrastructure. The best example for this is Compute Engine. So what Compute Engine does is they will offer you a Compute Engine which will have a different defined set of configuration and using which you can deploy your applications or any networking you want to do within that Compute Engine. You can do it and you will be billed for that Compute Engine charges. So you don't need to have that Compute Engine deployed into your location or anything like that. So because they are providing that infrastructure as a service, that the Compute Engine component comes into as infrastructure as a service. Again, when you go into platform as a service, there will be a component called App Engine. So App Engine, just a minute, I'm not able to move this. Yeah, this is software as a service. Okay, let's go through this Compute Engine first. So I don't have any defined set of slides to guide you through. So that's why I'm using this Google Cloud documentation. This is not with our course owners or anyone like me or anyone. This is available on internet from Google. You can refer this back anytime with your mobiles or anything. Okay. So this is what in IaaS, infrastructure as a service definition is. And you can browse through this, but in short, what I would tell you is that whenever you have a component which comes into this zone, what it does let you do is that it will provide the infrastructure needed. It will provide you the Compute Engine. It will provide you the CPU. It will provide you the memory within that service. And then you will be charged for the entire infrastructure is given. In the Compute Engine case, that's exactly how it's going to happen. So if you look at what are the benefits, it's economical, it's efficient. I mean, like you don't really need to have that completely infrastructure in your location. So that way it is economical and it is efficient because it can have that auto scaling mechanisms in few cases, and it will let you auto scale instantly and automatically as well. And it is reliable and scale. I mean, like the scalability is about like how exactly it can auto scale. It is reliable in the sense like there won't be any failures within this. As I said earlier, Google Cloud Network itself is really robust enough to support any kind of operations within this. So that's why it is reliable. And productivity is a I'd call it as a byproduct of all this, having a reliable network and having a scalable environment. Scalability is nothing but how you have taken a certain amount of Compute Engine, but at some point of time you want to have it to scale to a better, more frequency or better range, then it can auto scale that. So that's what auto scaling is for, and it drives faster time to market. I mean, this is a more of a marketing marketing benefit, I would call, because you're not having anything set at your own location, and we are not having any you don't need to do anything by yourself, right? Like, you just go and pick a compute engine from the cloud console, and that compute engine will start working within like three four minutes then and there itself. So you'll not lose any time when you want to go ahead and deploy something into that compute engine, which is readily available then and there itself. So that's what those are the benefits briefly. And what are the products within the IaaS are like, as I said, like the compute engine would be the best product to say, to example, the infrastructure as a service, and even cloud storage or virtual private cloud. These are the different components which can be given as an example here. Okay. Persistent disk, virtual machines. You know about this virtual machine, persistent disk, I believe, because a lot of us have this VMware backdrop, right? So you can correlate to the persistent disk as well. So how much time it will take for you to have a persistent disk in on-premise, and how much time you will have to spend to have a persistent disk on cloud is really, you can understand with that one parameter itself how much time, how big Google Cloud is, and how advantageous Google Cloud will be when it comes to using a cloud component. Okay. Any questions? Okay. When we go into PaaS, PaaS is nothing but an app engine. Simply to give an example. So what an app engine lets you is that an app engine lets you deploy your application without disclosing what kind of configuration you are using. So app engine will give you a platform to deploy your application, but compute engine will give you a compute engine itself, like with the configuration you want to configure, what kind of memory you want to have. Those kind of details will be there in compute engine. But when it comes to app engine, it will let you deploy your app into that app engine, but it won't disclose you a lot of details about like what is the infrastructure behind that app engine. So this will be as a platform. They'll give you a platform to deploy, but they'll not give you an infrastructure to deploy. So that's the difference between app engine and cloud compute engine. Okay. And there is a third component called as software as a service, which is more of like how you configure your product, any of the cloud component product, to just provide the service itself. It's not going to provide anything more than service. So this is a bit more easy when you really look at how exactly it lets you do that. Then you'll be able to understand it a bit more easily, because we don't have it in the syllabus as well. I'll not really confuse you with that. So you can go back to these two, infrastructure as a service and platform as a service concepts, and then come back to me if you have any questions. But these concepts are just to make you understand about how cloud platforms are devised, and what kind of work can be done, and what kind of use cases can be achieved using these. So for today, I would say we can conclude here with we have mostly covered the module one, but this components of Google Network Infrastructure, we haven't really took a deeper dive, or we haven't covered all the components here. But tomorrow we'll be able to do this, and we'll be able to cover, not exactly tomorrow, in the next session, I would call. In the next session, we'll be able to do this a bit more easily, and I'll have to provide you with the basic understanding of this console itself. So that's also we can cover in our next session. Any questions, guys? Yeah, I didn't get your question.
Do you have any tentative date for starting?
I don't have any tentative date myself. I'll have to check with the organizers so that they will give you a date and the schedule of these sessions. Yeah, and any other questions, guys, regarding your syllabus or anything?
I am from SQL database. I'm working for last 7 years. So is it include any migration from SQL database from on-premises to Google Cloud?
We are not going to set up a on-premise SQL instance and then move it into cloud. I mean, migrate into cloud. We are not doing that. But what we can show you is that how you can configure Cloud SQL in Google Cloud Platform, and then how you have to be working with that. That thing we can show you. But if you want to migrate an on-premise SQL database to on cloud, I mean, just because I don't have that on-premise instance, I'm suggesting this. If you have an on-premise instance on your machine which you want to move into cloud, you can try that by yourself. I'll be able to guide you through how to do that, but I'll not be showing it on my screen. That's what I meant. Yeah, any more questions?
Hi.
Yeah, Pratap, go ahead. You have given your mail ID. I didn't get Pratap, right? KMPR.
Yes, correct.
I got your mail ID, but I don't know, is it supposed to me or like anyone from the organizers?
No, for you only. Actually, someone messaged me how to send mail something.
Yeah, sure.
How to give mail something.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Okay. Actually, I want to know one thing. Already what we got to know. In Google Cloud, if you take cloud builder,
చెప్పండి తెలుగులో కూడా చెప్పొచ్చు, నో ఇష్యూ గైస్. థింగ్ విత్ లాంగ్వేజ్, నో డోంట్ వరీ అబౌట్ ఇట్. ఐఎమ్ ఫ్లూయెంట్ ఇన్ తెలుగు, హిందీ అండ్ ఇంగ్లీష్. ఐఎమ్ అఫ్రైడ్ ఐఎమ్ నాట్ రియలీ మోర్ దెన్ దాట్, బట్ ఇన్ ఎనీ లాంగ్వేజ్ ఆఫ్ దీస్ త్రీ. అండ్ ఐ రియలీ రిక్వెస్ట్ అదర్ గైస్ హు డోంట్ అండర్స్టాండ్ దీస్ లాంగ్వేజెస్ ఆల్సో టు బీ విత్ మోర్ పేషెంట్, సో దాట్ ఆర్ గైస్ within our network will be able to pose their questions easily. Yeah, cheppandi Pratap.
Google Cloud lo cloud build cloud source repositories set unnai rendu.
Yeah,
are rendu ki external repositories so ante ippudu cloud build lo triggers create cheyalanna like cloud source lo external repository connect cheyalanna.
Yeah,
only we github bitbucket are rendu maatrame kanipistayi.
Bitbucket కి ఆల్టర్నేటివ్ కూడా ఉంది మన దగ్గర గూగుల్ క్లౌడ్ లో. దట్స్ ఎ రీసెంట్ కాంపోనెంట్.
క్లౌడ్ సోర్స్ రిపాజిటరీస్ అనేది గిట్హబ్ చేసే పని చేస్తుంది.
యాప్
దాన్ని వేరే రిపాజిటరీస్ కూడా అక్కడ మిర్రరింగ్ చేయొచ్చు. దానికి గిట్హబ్ బిట్బకెట్ ఆ రెండు మాత్రమే ఆప్షన్స్ చూపిస్తుంది అక్కడ.
ఓకే,
మిర్రరింగ్ చేయాలంటే ఇప్పుడు అలా నేను గిట్ హబ్ అది క్లిక్ చేస్తే గిట్ హబ్ డాట్ కామ్ కి డైవర్ట్ అవుతుంది. బట్ నేను గిట్ హబ్ ఎంటర్ప్రైజ్ అంటే కంపెనీ గిట్ హబ్ ఉంటుంది కదా, దాంతో కనెక్ట్ చేయాలంటే అక్కడ ఆప్షన్ రావడం లేదు అనమాట. అది పాసిబుల్ అవుతుందా లేదా
ప్రతాప్?
Yes,
this question can be answered when we actually look into console. And I mean, I understand that you are trying to do something with the cloud build. I mean, just so that I detail that, this is about having your repository, and you want to have your continuous pipeline so that deployment happens automatically, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so we can do this once we go into the console and start doing this, but it will let you do that, but I'm not sure what error you are getting there. We'll look at that and we'll fix that later.
Okay. Okay, I have already this personal GitHub and personal Google Cloud also. Can I connect later?
Yep, you can connect later. That's what I'm suggesting. We'll connect later and we'll do this.
Okay.
Yeah. To conclude, today's session is completed. We will come back to the sessions once Darnell give you a schedule and timing of daily session. So thanks a lot of guys. So
hi Srikant, myself Lokesh. I have a question.
Hello. Yeah, Lokesh.
Hi. I'm very new to this IT environment. Actually, I'm from some other department in engineering. I'm from civil engineering, and I'm very new to IT field. And to opt this course, what are the prerequisites that I should have? Do I need to have something like a networking knowledge or coding knowledge or something like that?
Lokesh, I understand that you just want to understand Google Cloud as a whole, right? I mean, sorry. What is your objective? I mean, Lokesh, when you say you don't have,
I don't have any prior knowledge. I'm very new to IT field.
So what is your objective, Lokesh? So you want to understand Google Cloud so that you want to learn something, or
because few of my friends suggested me if I'm from some something like some other department, or if I have some other background other than IT or a CSE, they suggest me to go to cloud technologies or a DevOps or to the DevOps side. So I've started doing I've started a DevOps course recently. I've enrolled for one course, and they said nowadays GCP is evolving very fastly when compared to AWS and Azure. So I don't have any knowledge on AWS and Azure as well. I want to start with GCP. So to understand GCP, what are the things that I should have? Do I need to have any coding knowledge or networking knowledge or something that you can suggest, so that I'll start that one also simultaneously?
Lokesh, so to understand Google Cloud, if you have a basic idea of how the basic idea of cloud, you understand cloud, right? Why we are using cloud. I mean, when you say cloud, before you begin with cloud, how exactly software industry is working. I mean, what exactly is being done? I mean, simple questions and simple answers. If you are hosting a web application, I mean, we all use Google. So how exactly Google is able to pull the search results? Or if you are using a website, how exactly that website is built, and how exactly that website is hosted, and how it can have multiple use cases within that, and those kind of basic understanding you have. If you have, you will be able to understand Google Cloud as well. So Google Cloud, where I'm leading to this is, Google Cloud platform will let you do all this stuff which you are doing on premises. I mean, whenever I call on premise, if you want to have something deployed and hosted and into a website, you'll have to have some compute engine on your premise, in the sense your location in your office or in your home. You'll have to have the basic need of hosting that server, and then the server is required, and then you will have to have a lot of software before you actually host that website software into that server. So Google Cloud lets you do this without having any infrastructure. So you'll have to you'll be able to correlate when you actually understand how a web hosting works or how networking works. So you'll have to pick where exactly you're leading. You're leading into a DevOps environment. So you'll have to understand what exactly is DevOps, and for DevOps, what are the components within the Google Cloud you want to learn. So if you focus yourself on those things only, and anything which is not really connecting to you or like seems to be not in place with your line of thought, you can ignore that and you can move ahead with your topics. That's also fine. But it's good that you started with your DevOps training. That will also help you in understanding this as well, because there will be concepts which are interrelated with your DevOps and Google Cloud as well. Just like just Pratap asked about a question, right? That question is interrelated with DevOps and having a continuous CI/CD pipeline, and that pipeline to replicate the repository from one of his external cloud, external source repositories into Google Cloud. That's exactly he's trying to do, but it seems like he has an issue there. So if you have any backdrop of understanding a technology, not from your academics, it would be really handy to understand Google Cloud Platform.
Okay.
Any last questions, guys? Looks like everyone is dropping off when I said like here we are going to end the session, but we are still continuing after 10-15 minutes, it seems. Yeah, we have reached the 1 hour, also no issues on that as well, but if you have any questions, feel free to ask now, or else like you can ask in any of the upcoming sessions. Thank you all.